some say push on through. After all, it's the least that you can do. But don't buy what they're selling. Couldn't be further from the truth. What if I were the one to tell you that the fight's already been won? Well, I think your day's about to get better. What if I were the one to tell you that the work's already been done? It's not good news, it's the best news ever.
Hey, welcome everyone. Welcome y'all. We had a little bit of a welcome Ann up here this morning. Laura was sick. We found out this morning right before we came that she's sick, so we already said a prayer for her. Thank you, Ann, for stepping in. Welcome y'all. The gospel's not just good news, it's the best news ever. While we were on our best day, could not earn it. We don't deserve it. Meanwhile, God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to carry all of that guilty shame stuff, that grace is for everyone else but me stuff, what the Bible calls sin stuff. Jesus paid our debt in full on the cross. He defeated death, rose from the grave, is seated at the right hand of the Father, so that whoever believes in him will have eternal life, and that starts now. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Amen. Amen. Happy Palm Sunday. All right, I'd like to invite you all now. The Bible says, you know, come to him like a child. So I remember in my first grade Sunday school teacher, it's like, all right, y'all, I want you all to go to Jerusalem now. I don't want you to be right here. I want you to be in Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a rolling stone song, a beast of burden. And the crowds that went before him, that followed him, were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest! Hosanna means praise the Lord in the Hebrew. It's a plea for help. Save now. Save us, we pray. Let's pray. Father God, this is that part of the service where we just get on our knees. We just say that you are God, and we're not. just say Hosanna. We praise you, Lord. Hosanna, save us, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I see the King of Glory.
someone and greet them, would you? All right, we're going to do a new song. Cole brought this one to our attention. It's a great song, and I said he must be Irish. He's got the red hair and all. Turns out it's not true, right? Yeah, just a little bit. Anyway, if you're Irish, you'll probably be able to sing this right away. This is a great song for Holy Week. This is called You've Already Won. So feel free to sing along. You know, the scripture doesn't say, you know, to sing like Pavarotti. It says to make a joyful noise. So just go ahead and sing along, and even if you're out of key, just make a joyful noise. This is You've Already Won. Happy Palm Sunday, everybody.
Watch.
we will be.
We will be with you again.
You're my Savior.
You're my Savior, my defense.
No more fear in death. Do it again. Coming in like a roaring lion. We're going to ask the ushers to come forward. And if you're visiting here, man, we're glad you're here. This is just one of the ways we worship. We worship in fellowship. We worship in song. By hearing God's word, we worship with our offering. Speaking of Irish, last week I noticed Co did Be Thou My Vision, and I thought I'd look like I knew what I was doing for a change, so I looked this up. The gentleman was born by the name of Maywin Suckett. That's the guy we know as St. Patrick. When he was 16, pirates took him on a ship to Ireland, sold him to slavery. 6 years he was there as a herdsman. Sometimes he prayed as much as 100 times a day, sometimes another 100 times at night. He had a vision that he would escape one day, and on that day he escaped. And he sailed 3 days and then 28 days in the wilderness. And the British crew said, "Where's your God now?" as they were about to starve. He doubled down. He said, "Let's pray to God, you know, to take care of us." They came along an emaciated herd of pigs. So they were weakened because they were starving too. They were able to catch them and eat them. And they found wild honey. And so then in 433 AD, a king declared a Druid holiday, which was a false religion. You couldn't light a candle. I love this guy. He climbed the tallest hill, lit a bonfire, because this was at Easter. They did this at Easter. In the 8th to 14th century, a composer wrote a melody about that occasion. and they called it Slain, for Slain Hill, for what St. Patrick did. They don't know this for sure, but somewhere between the 8th and 14th AD, a poem was written. 1905, Mary Byrne found it, translated to English. 1912, Eleanor Holt took Slain Hill composer's music and put it to the poem of what we're about to sing now. That's Be Thou My Vision. Would you stand, if you're able, and worship? Down my vision. Here we go. Be thou my vision.
For you. No, no, there you go, bud. Thanks, Dennis, so much. All right. Good morning, everybody. Everybody doing well? Didn't sound like very convincing, just so you know. Well, here's what I am absolutely excited about. For Christians, for maybe those of you that aren't followers of Jesus, this is our big week, man. This is our big celebration. I love Christmas, so don't get me wrong. I love celebrating Christmas, not the one where we make lots of money on, but the Christmas where we actually celebrate the incarnation of Jesus. But this week is huge. And so what we're trying to do this week as a church to set it apart as a whole week in which we really do celebrate this week, I believe, as it is to be intended. Some backgrounds, they call it like a Passion Week, or they'll call it like the Holy Week. What we're choosing to just call it is the week where we're going to celebrate Jesus. So I know that doesn't sound very good, it doesn't have a good rhyme to it, but dang it, we're just going to celebrate Jesus this week. Now, in this celebration, just so everybody knows, it's going to come out of still the book of Matthew. But today what we're going to do is we're going to look at the coronation of the king. And I love this because this picture of the coronation of the king is unlike any other picture of the coronation I think that most people have seen before. Tomorrow we're going to have a devotion that's going to be for you online. John Reed, one of our elders, is going to be doing that, where he talks about the king clearing the temple. Tuesday, Steve, which, by the way, welcome back, Steve. What time zone are you in right now? Just got back from Singapore a little bit ago. And so, anyways, yeah. Well, welcome back, man. I'm glad to have you back. I just noticed you were sitting there. But he's going to be doing a devotion for us on just the idea of how he confronts in so many ways the people of the time. Wednesday, the King in Focus, Dan Lovejoy, is going to be doing that one. If you don't know anything about it, nothing in the Bible is written about what happens on Wednesday. So I'm looking forward to just Dan staring at the screen and spending 7 minutes of just quiet at the end going, amen. So, no, I can't wait to see. I haven't seen any of these, so I can't wait to see what's going to happen with that. Thursday, Christian's going to lead us through a Maundy Thursday. If you don't know what Maundy Thursday is, make sure that you come. It's going to be all around Jesus's, just his heart of service, his heart to establish a new meal for his people. So we'll be doing that together on Friday. Mike Steinwender is going to lead us through a Good Friday service where we really do focus upon the work of Jesus that he accomplished on the cross. Then on Saturday, Bob Krychek is right down here. He's going to be guiding us through what happened after the death of Jesus and before his resurrection. Now let me just say this. All of this is taking place because my whole heart is when we come back next Sunday, because we've spent time focusing on King Jesus, we're ready to explode. I want it just to be a celebration of praise of the victory of King Jesus over death, over Satan, over sin. I want to celebrate the king. No, hold back. Don't do it yet. Hold it all in. Just hold it in. Because I want it just to be an explosion next Sunday of our heart and our passion and our desire to know, love, and follow Jesus. You'll be able to find all that information on our website. And so if you go there, it's at the very top. You'll be able to hit the little arrows as you go through to kind of see which different ones you want to kind of engage in. But that will be there and available for you. So make sure you go to the website and participate. Let me just throw one last thing at you. Today we're not going to do the barbecue. We thought it was going to be raining today. And so we didn't want to purchase all the chairs and all the tables and all the food and then show up and then it's raining. But we said this before this. They said, you know, if we do it, it's going to rain. And if we don't do it, it's going to be sunny. So there's a weird part of me going, oh, Lord, just let it rain, man. But instead of like having a meal together, and the whole goal was to have a meal together to just focus ourselves upon what we're about ready to do for this week, would you consider taking a day to fast, to really focus upon King Jesus? And every time that you're hungry, to remind yourself of why that you're fasting, is that we want to have a focus upon Jesus. So that's up to you. It's between you and the Lord. But that's what's going on this week, and we can't wait for you to participate and to be involved in it. But today, we're going to talk about the coronation of the king. Now, I don't know how many of you have ever seen a coronation before, but today I hope my prayer is that it's coronation like you hope other coronations are like in the future if Jesus tarries. But could I have everybody stand up? I'm going to read the passage that we're going to be going through today. And after we read it, then we'll take a look at it. Matthew 21, verse 1. And we'll have the guys come down here in just a second with Bibles if you need them. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. untie them, bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them. And he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put them on their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest! And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. And all God's people said, amen. You can sit down. Now, the weird part about a coronation, just so you know, and by the way, if you need a Bible, you can raise your hand. There'll be some people bringing them down that we'd be happy to get you one. If you don't have one, please feel free to keep it. But for kind of Americans, the coronation thing is a little hard, right? We were born anti-king. We were born in the United States, dang it. We were born in the land of the free, the home of the brave, God, guns, and country, and don't you dare tell a king to ever tell me what to do. Don't tread on me, right? I mean, that's just kind of our mentality. Now, with this, though, it is pretty interesting that there's other cultures that have coronations. Now, on one level, I didn't think Queen Elizabeth was ever going to die. I seriously thought maybe she was eternal. And so along, though, finally comes King Charles. And for my wife, because I think she wishes she was British, she records everything that comes from, like, the weddings and different things. And so she might be a traitor. I don't know. I'm wondering. But I think what's so powerful about this is generally when we see coronations, this is what we see. We see pomp. We see majesty. We see ceremony. But in this one that we see today, it's going to look a little bit differently. See, in this one, in the text we just read, right, Jesus is coming in on his coronation. Eventually, he's going to say to Pilate, basically, I am king. My kingdom is not of this world. That's what he's going to talk about. It's clear that Jesus Christ truly is, right? He's King of kings. He is Lord of lords. He is not one to be trifled with. But today, what you're going to see is not the proud arrogance of a culture. You're going to see a man of humility. Now, when you see him, his coronation, like I said, is going to be one in which probably the Western world wouldn't understand. It's going to be one in which it's going to seem so strange that he has to arrange his own coronation. It's going to be one, though, that I would say this gives us a model, an example of what we as followers of Jesus are supposed to be like. See, I'm going to tell you a little story about this just to kind of get us going so that you can understand what I'm talking about. When I was a kid, we always used to go to parades, and I lived in Wyoming, so a parade without horses was like, I don't know, California without rain or without sunshine or something like that. It's just, you always had horses. But yet there was this clown that every single time we went to the parade that always rode a little donkey. And we always used to make fun of him and mock him, right? And so there's the clown, there's riding his donkey. But yet, this is exactly what Jesus is going to do. He's going to ride into this town on a donkey, in the words of Shrek. Now, with this, one of the things, though, I think that's so cool about this is he's going to demonstrate his kingship. Now, I worked really hard these last few days to create 5 words, and they all start with the letter P. So just so you know, this is a huge day for me because I'm not very good at this, but we're going to start off with the first one, all right? Here's the first one. Everything he begins with is all about preparation. Now in this, just so you know, Jesus is drawing close to Jerusalem, but it says in there that word they. Does everybody see that in verse 1, they? Now the they of that particular one definitely would have included Jesus. It would have included his apostles, his disciples, but it also would have included just the huge crowds that were going with him. See, at this time, crowds were all heading in. Jerusalem was probably a town of about 30,000 people or so at this particular time. But when they had Passover, it swelled to 150,000 people. So just imagine, he's coming with this group from the north. They're coming down, if you remember right, on that eastern side of the Jordan, and they cross over, and they get into Jericho, right? And they have Zacchaeus was a wee little man. And they also had the two blind guys, and they had the different people. But now they're coming into this, and the way that it talks about is they're now drawing near, specifically they're drawing near to Jerusalem, to this little town called Bethpage, which is about 2 miles east of Jerusalem, but specifically to the Mount of Olives. Now Matthew's really key on saying this, the Mount of Olives. Why? Well, because this is the path probably that David would have taken into town after he was kind of kicked out by his son Absalom, as he would have kind of come in from this particular direction. And so it would have had connotations of the king is returning. When I say preparation, Jesus was controlling and working things for a specific purpose to let everybody know he isn't just anybody. He's the Messiah. Not only does it go through there, but we also know this, that when he gets there, he's going to send two disciples to go do something for him, to prepare something for him. See, the one thing I want you to catch when we talk about this idea of preparation is Jesus is in absolute control of everything. If you remember right, all throughout his journeys, right, people would be like, let's make him king. This is the guy. And he'd always be like, shh, don't say anything. Don't talk about that. It's not my time yet. We don't want to cause people to be too upset at this particular point. But all this energy and all this pent-up reality of, no, I know who that is. That's the Messiah. It's just being stored up. And Jesus now, if you can just imagine like a balloon, it's just blowing up and blowing up and blowing up. And blowing up, and this balloon is about ready to go off. And he sends two of his disciples in this preparation thing. He's saying to them, basically, I want you to do something for me. Now, the strangeness of what this is that I think is so interesting is that you can tell in his preparation, he's trying to do something. He's trying to let people know not only who he is, but we know this whole week is going to go towards the point where it is going to be a collision of ideas in which you have the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Sanhedrin, the priests, all these different groups of people that are eventually one, they're going to kill him. That's one thing we know. And then there's other groups of people that are trying to make him king, and it's just this collision course that he's bringing to bear. But you're going to watch this. Jesus does not intend to stop it. He wants this collision course. He wants things to get riled up. Now, he's not trying to cause mutiny. He's not trying to cause a, you know, mass chaos. But in this, you can sense that he's controlling everything. He's allowing the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Sanhedrin and the different ones to start to know. You may think you're in control, but you're in control of nothing. And then he's now going to walk into this, and he tells them in verse 2, I want you to go into the village in front of you. I want you to go into Bethpage. And he says in there, immediately when you get there, you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. And then he says, untie them and bring them to me. Look at this, though. If anyone says anything to you, so say the Lord needs them and he will send them at once. Does anybody else feel that strange? Like, can you imagine if just somebody walks up and says to you, perchance, hey, I'm going to be taking your car. The master has need of them. You're going to be, I don't think so. Back to preparation, though. Jesus had actually prepared somebody in town to hear this code word. When you hear this, send your donkey and the foal. Now, everything about this was being prepared. And I think one of the things that we forget about in our lives and the things that are going on in the world, everything has been prepared from the beginning. See, at a time when I think Christians more than anything need to understand God's sovereignty, his power, his control, his omniscience, his omnipresence, his omnipotence, right now we as a church need to believe that, because with the world that feels like it's spinning out of control, which probably in this particular moment everything felt like it was going to feel like it was out of control, there is nothing out of the control of God's hand. And with Jesus in this moment, in his preparation, he's pulling it all together. Right? How often in your own life have you thought, my gosh, you know, down the road, after the event has already taken place, I'm from Wyoming, I can say whatever I want. But in this, right, how often, though, do we look back on something and just go, oh my gosh, God was weaving that together. Cornerstone, followers of Jesus. God is in control. It may not feel like it at times, but God is in control. Well, what if Joe Biden or Donald Trump wins the presidency? He's in control. What if I face sickness? He's in control. Our God is in absolute control. And even in this moment, as Jesus is orchestrating all things, he is demonstrating, I'm in control. So he says to them, untie him and bring him to me. In other words, it's all a preparation. Now you can imagine just for a second the idea of dominoes. If you've ever set up dominoes before and hit the first domino, have you ever done that? I've had kids, a lot of my kids, that some of them couldn't wait for maybe the fourth domino to be put up, and they're already, you know, hitting that one. And then there's others that will let me build this extravagant. But I love hitting that first domino and watching everything take off. What Jesus in a cool way is doing is he's taking the first domino and he's putting it up in front of all of them and says, bring me the donkey and the colt. And he's about ready to do this. And what you're going to watch, and this is the big thing, we've been talking about preparation, but the other thing is you're going to watch prophecy after prophecy after prophecy after prophecy, that when he hits this first domino coming into town, we're going to see all kinds of prophecies fulfilled that the Old Testament promised would happen. It would see the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We would see everything, but you need this first domino, the first one in which now it's going to be tipped as he comes into town, and he's setting that one up. And even Matthew says this in this whole preparation when he talks about it. Oh, by the way, verse 4, this all took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet. I think this is always one of the greatest arguments for the validity and the absolute truthfulness of the scriptures. Prophecy after prophecy after prophecy that gets fulfilled. In this case, it's a guy named Zechariah. He's an interesting cat. A prophet at this particular time, towards the end, he's the second to last book in the Bible, or in the Old Testament. But in this, he's going to write, and he's going to start off in this particular case with Isaiah 61, but then he's going to move on, and verse 5, he's going to say to the daughter of Zion, in other words, speak to the people of Israel, speak to the people of Jerusalem. Now look at this. Behold, your king is coming to you. Now, if you just stopped there, in the back of your mind, you're like, oh, the king is coming? Well, if I heard the king was coming, man, I'd be gone, and I'd be getting on my best clothes. Probably the king's coming to us. Well, dang. Now, look at these next words. Humble. Like, when's the last time you thought about a king and humble? Mounted. Oh, he's going to say horse, a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. Now, Zechariah 9:9, just to kind of go back there, you don't have to go there in your Bibles, but in the first seven verses of Zechariah 9, he's been talking about this great conqueror, this human conqueror, that the opening kind of seven verses see, most commentators see, is this person named Alexander the Great, a guy from Macedonia that came through, if you remember right back in the day, and he just swept through what was the then known world and conquered everything through power and majesty and military force. He was the chief of the chief. In fact, not only was he just anybody, but he became known as and was given the title Protector of Israel. But here, when you look down in these verses, starting to verse 9, you don't see someone that is this great strategic general. You don't see somebody that is coming in peace and humility. You see something else completely different. But you see in there, he's coming, and look at that. And inside of verse 9, he's coming with salvation. Sure, he's coming on a donkey. He's coming in humility. But in verse 10, he's not going to come in with a chariot. He's not going to come in with war horses. He's not going to come with a battle bow. That part shall be cut off. But he's going to say to them, behold, your king, Israel, he's coming to you. He's not just coming, he's coming to you. Most kings would expect you to come to them, but he's coming to you. Look at that, he's righteous in verse 9. He says salvation. Then he also says after there, he's humble. He's mounted on a donkey, on a colt, on the foal of a donkey. Now just think about the juxtaposition between Alexander the Great and this guy. Here's what's even crazier. Look at verse 10. He shall speak peace to the nations. He's not going to come in war. He's not coming in this particular point as one who's going to demand the war upon other people. But his rule, look at this, will be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the world. In other words, he's coming in and expecting to do world conquest. Now think about how strange that seems. I understand Alexander the Great. I understand Rome. I understand all the great mighty empires that have come. I understand the mighty empire of the United States with our nuclear and all our weapons that we have. They're the ones that are going to do conquest over the entire earth. But he says in there, this one riding the donkey, this one with salvation in his hands, this one that's coming in with humility, this one that's coming in this way, he's going to conquer the world. How? Verse 5, back in Matthew 21, this king will be the Messiah. And this king that he's talking about in this particular case is Jesus. And what's so crazy is they brought the donkey and the colt. And it says they put on them their cloaks, and Jesus sat on them and basically said, let's go. Now, here's what's crazy about this story. Jesus never once rode any kind of an animal in any part of Judea or Samaria, anywhere that he went. He never rode anything. He always walked along with his guys. Not only that, but whenever you would come in for Passover, there was kind of an unwritten rule, an unwritten understanding that we find in some of the other writings, that when you're about a mile or two outside of Jerusalem, even the wealthy people who were riding something into town would get off, and they would walk kind of through the Song of Ascent, it's called, some of the later Psalms. They would walk in singing with all of the people, and the only person that would ever ride into a town on any type of a beast, whether we're talking an animal or a donkey, we'll even see that with, like, Solomon. He rode in on a donkey at one point. The only people that do that are kings. What was Jesus saying? I'm king. That's who I am. I'm coming into town, and I'm not just saying I'm anybody. I'm king. Now, you know this was thrown down the gauntlet. In the back of our minds, though, we got to wonder, he's prepared everything. He's fulfilled a prophecy. So what happens next? Well, the thing that happens next is praise. Look at Matthew 21. Most of the crowd, it said, spread their cloaks on the road. When we get to 2 Kings 9, that was a sign of respect in which they would lay cloaks down on the ground. And when somebody would ride over it, it was showing them that you respected them. When they got by, you would pick your cloak back up and you would put it on. In other words, the crowd that's coming in from Galilee, that's now walking that mile or two into town, they are going, oh, I know exactly what he's saying. He's claiming to be king. And in this particular case, then, they take off their cloaks and they lay them down at his feet. Not only that, it's just they start to cut down palm branches. We know palm branches like from like John 12, where it talks about in a lot of ways, palm branches were used for the joy of salvation. In other words, they're like, oh, the king is returning to save us. And they start cutting down palm branches and putting them down, creating this regal carpet that's going to follow him all the way into Jerusalem. And it says in there, not only in that, is that the crowds then went before him and followed him and were not just doing anything, they were shouting. Now, probably at this particular time, there were thousands of people that would have been a part of this entourage coming from the north, coming now in through Bethpage, coming into Jerusalem. And if you can imagine a couple thousand people walking at you, what that sound must have been like. They're screaming, it says in there, Hosanna, the crowds were. The crowds were they went before and were after. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. They just keep saying this over and over and over again. Now the key off this one is, though, is to understand it, is that it's connected to the Son of David. They got who he was. King's coming back. Now, they may not have known fully what he was about ready to do, but they knew the king was coming back. Hosanna, some people think it means something along the lines of today's salvation. It was probably more of an exclamation point where it had way more to do with a proclamation of the greatness of this one who is the Son of David. It was extolling him. It was making sure people saw he was the honored one. And as they did these different things, it would have had the idea of swearing allegiance to a king. You are who you say you are. We now worship you. Now notice Jesus is letting it go. Jesus doesn't say to him, no, calm down. Shh. We don't want to do this. We're going to draw attention to ourselves. Instead, he rides and it just picks up momentum. In fact, the use of the word there is it just grows louder and louder and louder. There are these events in history that I've always thought I wanted to be. Can you imagine being there that day? Now, in this, though, what's so interesting is that once we understand that there was preparation and prophecy and praise, there's another word that I think is important here, and it's the word pressure. Now all this noise and clamoring is coming, and it's coming into Jerusalem, and it says in there, when he entered Jerusalem, look at this word, the whole city was stirred up. That word's agitated, shaken. It's like an earthquake. The whole crowd, it says in Luke, was praising God with a loud voice that was coming in with him. And the Pharisees commented with these words. They said to the groups of people that were around him, the whole world has gone after him. In other words, we're in trouble. What was Jesus doing? In an interesting way, he was increasing the pressure inside of the town. He knew that by coming in, he was going to stir a hornet's nest. He knew by coming in, he was going to cause those Pharisees that were used to having power and control over people in the various towns in which they lived. He knew that the priests were going to be freaked out because they had a unique relationship with the Romans, and the Sanhedrin did it well in kind of a unique way. And so if we can just keep everything calm, everything will be okay. And Jesus is just like, mm-mm. Psh, psh, psh. Just creating more pressure and more pressure and more pressure. We also get in there, though, that some groups of people were like, who is this? What's all this noise? Who is this one that comes in riding on a donkey? Who does he think he is? And I love the words of the people. Not only is he a king, but he says that they say, this is the prophet Jesus, these ones coming into crown. He's from Nazareth of Galilee. In some ways, sometimes Jesus is this one who is a prophet. Sometimes he's a priest. Sometimes he's a king. But he encompasses all those. In other words, the one you've longed for, the one that was to be the return of Moses, the one that was to be the return of David, the one that was to be the return of the great high priests, there he is. Your king, your prophet, your priest has arrived. And there was pressure. I was thinking about that for those of us that are Americans in the United States. See, like I said, I'm a kid that grew up on a ranch and a farm, you know, in some ways in Wyoming. When you're born, they hand you a gun and a horse. Not really. But when you say to me, we're going to go on world conquest, I want to go on world conquest on a big white quarter horse with a flowing mane and a tail. And I want to have a cowboy hat and two guns on my side. And I want to be riding off into the sunset. That's who I want to be. I want to be that picture, if you've ever seen the movie The Lord of the Rings, right? When they come over the hill and there they are, you know, and they're riding on their white horses and they're coming down over the hill and the sun's breaking over the top of it. I'm like, that's who I want to be. Yeah, come on, we're going to go defeat the bad guys. That's right. And yet Jesus is calling all of us not to ride horses, but donkeys. Can you imagine Cornerstone mounting up on donkeys to come take the, let's go get them. It just doesn't sound the same, does it? But that is the juxtaposition. We are not called to be people of the stallion. We're a people of the donkey. We're called to be transformational in our community. We are called to do world conquest, not with weapons of war, not with cunning, not with politics. In fact, every time the church throughout history has gotten involved in war and politics and cunning and try to manipulate everything, the church loses its power. But when we're riding a donkey, oh, watch out. There was 120 people that we knew of at the time that when Pentecost hits, we had, that's how many Christians there were. Within less than 300 years, there were over 1 million, and by the middle of the 4th century, Christianity had spread over the entire then known world. We never had the kingship. We never had the Senate. We never had the protest and do these different weird things that Christians do now. There was no religious right. There were no Bill of Rights. We didn't need those. Why? Jesus is king. You can't stop his people. Put a wall up and communism will fall. Send us into any known part of the world. Watch out, because when God's people get in there, it may cost us dearly, but the gospel is so powerful. The gospel is so true. The king is so great. But yet he's riding on a donkey. Why? Because a donkey conveys, come to me. Come to me. He's going in as a humble, meek servant, not to destroy the people in that sense. He dies to defeat death. He hangs on a cross and defeats the evil one. He's raised from the tomb, and he absolutely kicks the door down on death. Cornerstone. When we exit out of here today, I hope we become known as Cornerstone, the people of the donkey. Why? Because if you want to win a culture, we don't do it from a white horse. We do it from a posture of humility. We do it from a posture of coming alongside into people's lives and not inviting them to ourselves, but inviting them to the king. And I would say in an election year, oh, Cornerstone. Can you imagine if they asked Jesus, hey, we've got an election in Rome right now. And we're going to have to vote for this evil person or that evil person or whatever it is. Jesus, who are you going to vote for? I think Jesus would have said what he'd said to both Herod and Pilate, my kingdom is not of this world. Cornerstone, your kingdom is not of this world. We are to be great citizens of this great nation that we're a part of. We are. But who reigns and rules over us? His or her breath is held in the hand of God. We cannot be worried people but we are people of the donkey. You with me? Now, I said this to my son. He and I were kind of talking. I was telling him what I was learning about. And I got to go forward here. And this is my last P. But that time is passing. Now, he and I were just talking. We're on the way to school. And I was like, man, here's what I'm learning. You know, Jesus and like this idea of donkey, you know. And I kind of shared how funny I thought it would be to imagine like most people, you know, it's like if you were creating your team sports name in high school, you wouldn't be like, you know, we're going to be the Stallions. We're going to be the Broncos. Very few people go donkey, right? And so I was just like, oh, that sounds kind of funny to me, you know. And he kind of got quiet. And then we started talking about, though, Revelation 19. And I want to create that for just a second. See, to help you feel the wonder of this kind of moment that we live in right now, this history of the world that we're a part of, the kingship of Jesus looks very different. The kingship of Jesus is inviting people. It's inviting people to come to their king, to lay their cloaks down in front, to swear their allegiance to him, to see him for who he truly is. But there's coming a time where John writes about it, and he says, then I saw in heaven opened up, and behold, a white horse. Notice, not a donkey. And the one sitting on it is called faithful and true, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire. On his head are many diadems. There's no crown of thorns in this case anymore. There are diadems, and he has a name written that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of fury of the wrath of God, of God the Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. To all of you in here that don't know Jesus, let me just say this to you. Now is the day of your salvation. The humble, meek one is right now calling, come to me now. Come. I am humble. I am meek. The rest of the story of what we're about to talk about throughout this Holy Week is all of how he draws you to himself. You are one who is sinful, separated from God in absolute shame, but by his grace and goodness, his death took, and he bore the price of sin and shame upon himself so that you might now live in righteousness because of his work. You used to be someone who was facing death and an eternity apart from him, but he kicked the doors not only over physical death, but life that was now life truly that we experience inside of God. And he is calling out to the world, and the church still, with all the authority that God has given to the Son, is proclaiming this incredible message on a daily basis, and people are coming to know him, and he is receiving in people from every tribe, every tongue, every nation. But there will come a time where that acceptance of Jesus will come to an end. And if you don't know him, you don't want to run into that one. Because a rod of iron means there's no longer mercy and grace, but judgment and wrath and fury. But today he's saying, throw your cloak on the floor, put down the branches, bend your knee, and you will find a king who is humble and meek and good and gracious. But if you don't, your knee will bow one day, but it will be in horror. And so if you're somebody here today that doesn't know Jesus, I can't say this enough. Today is the day of salvation. Come. Now, for those of you that are followers of Jesus, let me make sure I say this as clearly as I possibly can. King Jesus has won, is winning, and King Jesus will be victorious. And because he is victorious, listen to me, because he's victorious, we are victorious too. So followers of Jesus, I know we go through rough times. I know we have ups and downs. I know this world is not easy. I understand in some ways the affliction and the difficulty that we face. But never forget, King Jesus wins. If the elections don't go the way that we kind of want them to, don't get dour and sour. Look at it and go, oh, come quickly, Lord Jesus. No, I'm one level I'm kidding, but another level I'm not. Understand, nothing can thwart the power, the will of our great God. And so in the name of the Father, who is beckoning to the world, through his Son, who died and was buried and rose again, through the power of his Holy Spirit, may those that don't know him today come to know him, and Cornerstone to the rest of you. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, may we exit this building as Cornerstone, the great donkey riders. And all God's people said,
please stand up. We had a great song. Brother Todd, he was saying the lyrics to it. You know, every nation and tribe, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And but Laura got sick. So you ready to get on your donkeys and sing another song?
Storm, you cast out the demons. You walked on water like Peter. I stand and step out in faith, even when I am sinking. You hold my hand. Your living water brings peace like a river. When all my sorrows like sea billows roll, in all my trials you've taught me to say, it's well with my soul.
Sing it out.
It's amazing, amazing grace.
Here we come to this week.
A crown of thorns they mocked and they beat you. You bore my sin on Calvary that day. Laid you in a tomb, but death could not hold you. The stone was rolled away. Saved a wretch like me. Some will reject, some have eyes to see. So much power to make crashing waves cease. Jesus is bigger, he's bigger than we think. Jesus brings rescue and all God's people sang. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
saved a wretch like me. One more time if you mean it. It's amazing, amazing grace. Saved a wretch like me. I am found. I have eyes to see. It's a miracle. You saved a wretch like me. It's a miracle. You saved a wretch. Give him a shout of praise. Amen. Amen.
See John's pretty face when it comes on. We chose not to put people like me so that people would come to our website. That'll be Monday. Tuesday, like I said, it'll be Steve. Also Tuesday evening, we'll be having elder prayer. Just to clarify for everybody, when we say elder prayer, it's not so much a prayer meeting as much as it is to make sure that we as elders are able to pray for you. If you have sickness, if you're just kind of beat down and battered by life, we love to pray over our people just in that particular moment. So anyway, Steve, and then Wednesday will be Dan. Thursday will be Christian. Friday will be Steve. Saturday will be Bob. Did I say it wrong? Friday's Mike. Same thing. But then we'll come back and we'll do Easter service. But please take this week, focus on King Jesus. Make it a point to truly say this week we're going to devote ourselves to King Jesus. Now, the other things, some of the things we have coming up, just for you to be aware of, is that we've also have our various Bible study methods, classes that are coming after Easter. So you can check that out on our website, or you can check it out on that QR code if you would like to. We offer both introductory type things to Bible study methods, but then we also offer more of an intermediate, how to kind of grow in your understanding of doing that. We also have Bible reading groups, which you can dive into those no matter what. We have a reading plan for you. We would love for you, if you have want to start with us even right now, maybe you're just hearing about this Bible reading plan, and you want to read and have groups of people to meet with to talk it over, you can also go to our website and you can find that. Then lastly, coming up on April 1st, we have signups, and this is no joke, by the way. We have signups for VBS. And so we would love to have you start signing up. Make sure you sign up, and make sure also invite people along with you that maybe don't know Jesus. Invite kids that don't know Jesus to come be a part of this. And so make sure you sign up for that. Make sure you look for opportunities to be able to serve. But I'm excited for this week, and I want you to be excited for this week. I believe that we choose to dive in and we choose to commit ourselves to truly focusing upon King Jesus. We will not regret it. In fact, I think we will find hope and joy and peace and love like we're supposed to when we seek after the great King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So God bless you this week as you participate in the wonderful work of Jesus over this Holy Week. All right? God bless y'all. Yeah.